Good evening, plebeians, and welcome to the February 20th edition of RCM On Tap, your 60-ish minute roundtable discussion on topics everyone here at RivalCast is talking about. Our table topic tonight counters a lot of negativity that surrounded the gaming culture and media as of late. We'll center discussion around the good in gameplay tonight, positive aspects of the communities we're involved in, as well as the different lessons that games have taught us. But first, let's introduce tonight's panel. And actually, before I even do that, let's mute Twitch so that I'm not hearing myself talking in my own ear, because I do that a lot. All right, so joining me as always, the ever-reliable BiomedAlchemist.
Hello, everybody.
Yay! And Killer McCoy.
Howdy.
Yay again! And in the hot seat tonight, one of our most visible show hosts here at RCM. He co-hosts the WoW Uncensored Monday nights here on our Twitch TV channel at 10 Eastern, and does it again Tuesdays when he hosts the always entertaining Sheep Moon, 6 p.m. right here on the RivalCast Media Twitch channel. Please welcome the guardian himself, Deededee!
I don't know what to do with my hands.
Oh. We don't even have a camera on you. You don't have to worry about things like that. Ah,
that makes it worse. It matters then.
Speaking of cameras tonight, oh my gosh. Well, first of all, I, of course, am your co-host and moderator, the Baroness von Gosu. You'll notice that usually I have my camera up and running this evening. It is not. So you get the little stare down from me and my avatar of the evening. It wouldn't be a Friday night if I didn't have a tech glitch of some kind. So, you know, we're just going to roll with it because, you know what, I'm in a great mood. It's, you know, the end of a long week and we've got some great conversation, you know, planned for tonight. So let's get it started. Dee, I'm going to start off with you. So our first question for tonight.
No pressure.
For our icebreaker. What has been your proudest moment or accomplishment as a gamer?
Oh, wow. Now, see, forewarning, I have no idea what the topics are tonight.
You're supposed to keep this professional.
That's kind of on purpose. My proudest gaming moment. I have two, and they involve early life stuff.
Mm-hmm.
When I was 4 years old, my mother famously works at a theater. She has since I was 9 months old, and she still works there to this day. And I'm in my mid-30s, so she's been there a long time. But back in the early to mid-80s, there was always arcade games in the lobby. And I would go there after school. I would sit in the office and do my homework. And my reward for getting my homework done, yes, I had homework at 4 years old. It's not weird.
Nope, not whatsoever.
My mom's boss used to give me like a fistful of quarters to go and play the arcade games in the lobby.
Oh, snap.
That so, is awesome.
At 4 years old, we had four arcade games in the lobby. We had Mappy, we had Pole Position 2, we had Dig Dug, and we had the original Pac-Man. At 4 years old, using roughly $5 in quarters, I managed to complete all 255 levels of Pac-Man.
Wow!
Jeez.
Damn.
You want to talk about partially raised in an arcade, this guy.
I know, right?
Holy
That's
crap.
Awesome.
But one that even trumps that.
What?
1991. You know, fighting games, like Street Fighter II was huge. Art of Fighting was just coming out. All the fighting game boom started. Across the hall, because our movie theater's at a mall, across the hall was the arcade. So once that opened, I spent a lot of time there.
Mm-hmm.
11 years old, they hosted the arcade hosted an inaugural Street Fighter II tournament, and I won at 11 years old without dropping a single round.
Holy crap.
And I was playing against like 20 and 30 year old guys, you know, like college kids, high school kids, and I'm just this little fifth grader, and I won.
Cha-ching.
And that's been kind of a running theme throughout my teenage years. So I'd say those two are my like proudest moments in gaming. Aside from, you know, like all the WoW stuff and everything after that, those two like stick out in my mind the most.
Well, I'm actually kind of regretting letting you go first now because I don't think any of us can come close.
Why'd you do that, Baroness?
Check and mate.
God damn it.
I mean, I can keep going. I could say because this arcade, once fighting games became more popular and popular every week, I made top eight in every single tournament they ever held and won more than half of them. But we won't get into that. We'll stick with those two.
Man,
Guy's going to be an Evo. He's going to be an Evo. It's got to happen.
I was just all excited because I was going to talk about, you know, when my accomplishment as a gamer, because I don't play. I mean, the more I think about it, I actually have played a bit more as far as different video games than I tend to think about on a regular basis. But I dabble. I don't have anything, with the exception of The Sims. There hasn't really been many games that I've really connected to. So most of my gaming memories are just kind of, you know, hit and miss here and there. But I was really excited about, we have, like, as far as console games are concerned, the only console platform I've ever really cared for is the Wii. And so, like, my biggest accomplishment, which is, like, nothing now, is in the Wii Resort, there was this game where basically you were flying around this little airplane and you had to do these different maneuvers to kind of find and catch different little badges. And you got, like, special, you know, extra stuff that opened up in your game if you managed to, you know, collect all of the badges on this island in different, you know, levels of difficulty. So I was all excited because this is the only game that I have ever played where there was a quest that I actually followed through to the very end. Because again, usually I just kind of, like, you know, dabble around and do what I want. So the fact that I had the initiative to actually go through not just, like, the basic level, but, like, actually work my way through all the harder levels just to get these different things, I was rather proud of myself for that. I mean, it's definitely not, you know, kicking ass at Street Fighter at 11, but...
Hey, that's nothing to be ashamed of, though. I played that stupid Pilot Wings minigame, and oh my, it frustrates the hell out of me. I hate it.
I get into it, and it's like a zen moment for me. It's just like, you know, the first couple minutes, it's like, okay, you crash your airplane because you're letting the stress out, and it's just, it's entertaining. But then... You know, after you start getting in the zone, it's just like, it's like, it's better than yoga. You're just, like, sitting there, like, floating in the living room, like, let's do some loop-de-loops. What the hell? There we go. I'll get some more badges. Oh, let's sweep by those sheep.
Speaking of sheep.
All right, killer.
Well, considering I... God damn it, D, really?
Sorry, God.
All right, well, I had two proudest moments, and mm-hmm. both deal with WoW, when I used to play WoW, back during the Wrath of the Lich King. Our guild was doing a 10-man run on Ulduar, just doing it, you know, I don't really think it was a progression, we were just doing it to do it. It was, you know, several months after it came out, so we weren't top tier whatsoever. But we got to Ignis the Furnace Master. He was like the second or third boss. Basically, I was a paladin tank. I was the off tank of the raid. And we were going to do the quick and dirty way of killing him by just having me, I'll grab all the adds that come in, which you can't kill them unless you position them, get them burned, then put them in water. Then you could shatter them. So basically what we were going to do is I was just going to keep grabbing them and holding them for forever. And the main tank, which is tank Ignis by the pool. So we're doing it, and we're doing it. Then suddenly, somehow, there's a damage spike. The tank goes down. Immediately, one of the highest threat DPS gets killed, and one of the healers get killed. I instantly react, grab Ignis, pull him back into position, and I'm still tanking the other adds. And each time other ads keep spawning in, I'm grabbing them. By the end of the fight, I had grabbed like 10 of the ads and was tanking the boss.
Nice.
And we downed it.
Barely. I remember progression, Ignis, and that's not a small feat. That's actually kind of a big deal.
Yeah, well, I think we were slightly overgeared for that fight, so it wasn't that... To me, what was so epic was... I was able to hold on to the ads, grab Ignis without anyone else dying, and hold on long enough for the DPS to kill him.
That's awesome.
My second one is same expansion pack, but it was the actual Lich King himself. This we were actually were progressing, and this was like our 10th or 11th try on the Lich King. We finally had gotten to the very last phase with all these little pools of darkness, you know, spawning on the ground. Of course, if you get hit by them, they grow bigger, and then eventually they cover the entire platform. Do you remember that, right?
Don't stand defile. Don't stand defile.
Exactly.
Get out of defile. Get out of defile. Yeah, I remember defile.
Oh, God, those were terrible. They were such a
best
pain.
Best mechanic in the game of all time ever.
Exactly. So, again, I was the off tank, and we were tanking. I think we had a bear druid tanking him at the time. And everything was going pretty well. Then somehow he kills the tank. Just kills the tank. And we lose several other people. And we're trying to figure, oh, crap, it's a wipe. I grab him. I can pop everything I got because we're down to that last percentage. And it's almost in rage time. We kill him barely. At the end of the fight, I died. And the DPS and one healer were still alive at the end of it. And they got him down to the last 10%. Which triggers the event.
That's awesome.
So those are my two proudest moments. I was able to step up in a way and just make sure we didn't fail.
I love moments like that.
I know, they're great.
I mean, we still have them to this day. We had a similar event happen when we were progressing on, I think it was Hans and Franz, which is in BlackRock Foundry. Tanks go down. I'm one of the tanks that go down. Everybody's hurrying to try to get a battle res up. They get me up. I grab both the bosses and barely survive until the end with like half the raid dead. It's,
oh man,
it's a beautiful thing when something like that just barely scrapes by. I love it. That's one reason why I love raiding.
Awesome. All right, Bio, you're up. What is your proudest?
I've been trying to think of which ones necessarily stick out. Anytime I've managed to beat, you know, a game on hard, for someone like me, it's like, yes, I finally beat it. There was an MMO that was out in the kind of early 2000s called Dragon Raja. Mm-hmm. It was one of those Korean ports, and it was well known for having a lot of hackers in it. Mm-hmm. So I would say my accomplishment was I kind of figured out not how they were hacking or whatever, but I figured out their behavior, and I was able to play the game without being killed by hackers.
Nice.
So I had that for me, which was nice, which, yeah.
That is impressive.
Just like they had certain schedules. They'd show up in some places. They'd like kill PK everyone. It was one of those games where you basically, once you left certain parts of cities, there was a kind of a magic circle. Once you left that, it was just full on PvP. So yeah, I managed to live. The other one's a little bit more sentimental, but just kind of the people that, you know, playing games have kind of gotten me into, you know, meeting people that I may not have, you know, stepped out of my little bubble and talked mm-hmm. to. And I always had that thing to kind of point like, oh, you're playing this game? Yeah, it looks kind of cool. What do you think of it? And, you know, it's something where I can go to a lot of places and have, you know, some way to start a conversation with someone. Whereas, you know, most time I'm, you know, I talk to people, but it's a little bit different when you're talking to someone about a shared hobby.
Exactly.
And it is just, you know, how about that weather? This, you know, this bus is late, or when's the subway going to pull in? You know? Rah, 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 rah. So, yeah, that's the main... I mean, I have others, but I just don't want to list them, per se.
No, I understand. Well, cool. So, sounds like we've had a lot of really great experiences and, you know, kind of done a lot with that. It made us feel good. So let's move on to the next question. I'm actually kind of interested to hear what you guys think of with this question. Because this is one of the tougher questions I think I've come up with. What one game have you learned the most from? And what did you learn from it? And Killer, I'm going to start with you just because I know you have a little bit of stuff prepared.
Well, not per se, but I wouldn't say I learned it from this game, but I think it really reinforced it for me. And of course, I'm WoW is basically was the game, and basically was you need to know your role mm-hmm. and bring your best mm-hmm. because in a, during rating D, you know, if everyone knows their role, things go a whole lot smoother.
Oh yeah.
And moments like where half the raid gets killed, you somehow pull it off because everyone knows their role and they bring their best. So yep. Don't bring any, also based on another thing would be like, don't have any thinking your way is the only way isn't always the best way. Mm-hmm. Sometimes
thinking most of no the time. Some,
yeah, exactly. But, like, total basic, when I used to listen to Blue Please, he always moaned and complained. Well, not moaned. He was so distraught about how people, oh, I'm a special snowflake. I want to have my particular build always work. Every build should work for everything.
Well, and we all know that even in real life, you know, you can have things that are supposed to work in a certain way, and you do everything right, and it still, like, for whatever reason, doesn't come out the way it's supposed to.
Yeah.
So,
basically, it's like the game is math. Mm-hmm. You should use that math to help you get an edge. Don't try to fight the math because the math might change, but that's the whims to, you know, the developers. But in sometimes life, math is math. The numbers are numbers. Mm-hmm. You can't fight them. So you must well, better well just try to figure them out and use them to your advantage.
Awesome. See, for me, like my game, and I took kind of a similar thing to you. It's not something specific to the game, but something I got out of it that just kind of was reinforced by the game. For me, first of all, the game was The Sims. It actually,
of course,
the whole Sims series from start to finish, because it and this will make more sense in a second, but it, like, with the first Sims, just kind of reinforced something that I believed in and kind of gave me a way of articulating a thought that I had in the back of my mind, but I wasn't sure how to exactly describe it. And The Sims became like a perfect metaphor to kind of describe what I was thinking, which was nice because for a very long time I thought I was alone in the world. And being able to kind of share, like, okay, this is what's going on in my head with others, and have others say, you know, hey, you're not alone because we feel the same way, was a pretty amazing moment for me. And the nice thing about The Sims, too, I mean, The Sims basically provides the sketch plate for my philosophy on how the world works and the greater universe at large works. I mean, if you break it down, it's you essentially have, you know, a user playing this game, building this world with, you know, they make their little people, they give them, you know, flaws, they give them, you know, these different things, they put them in different situations to kind of progress a story. Because really, all The Sims is, you know, is telling a story through these digital characters. You know, you create the world, you create who these people are, you know. Certain characters you're going to play with a little bit more than others. Certain other characters, you know, you're just going to, you know, kind of set up as NPCs and let them go. Their purpose is to interact with, you know, the main characters that you're working with. And for me, it's a good metaphor for faith. I mean, if you think about it, for me, you don't know what's out there as far as creators are concerned, but, you know, I believe that there's something. And so why couldn't it be, you know, just somebody playing a game and, okay, maybe, you know, you're a little more interactive with certain things at one point, and then for a while you're not played with as much, you know? So.
Well, that explains my 5-year dry spell then.
Oh, you burned up.
I know.
It'll come back, killer. It'll come back. It's all right. But yeah, I mean, that for me, I mean, That gave me the way to kind of articulate what I was feeling. And again, you know, The Sims is one of the few games that I've really connected with over the years. So, you know, it's also one of the few games that then I'd go online and I'd, you know, participate in the communities and talk with other, you know, Sims people. And, you know, even if I wish I could have found the meme earlier because I was thinking about it and I couldn't find where I put it. But people even have, like, the little back and forth conversations, like, you know, have you ever walked into a room and you knew that you were going in there for something and then you just stop and stare at the wall for a few minutes and forget what it was you were doing? Isn't that kind of like when in The Sims, like, you go in with, you know, an objective in mind and then the creator just, like, cancels that out, so then you're just waiting for the next thing to pop in your head? I was like, oh my god, somebody else does that too! So, just having that kind of connection with others is what I got out of it, and it made a huge impact on me.
That so. Role in the Matrix, apparently.
Yeah.
I knew it!
Whoa! No way!
Whoa.
Alright, Bio, you.
Okay. I'm going to say one of the obvious things I kind of learned was strategy. Mm-hmm. My cousin introduced me to Magic the Gathering when I was in elementary school.
Nerd! And,
yeah, love the crap out of that game. I never played with people in real life because I didn't know anybody who played for the longest. But, I mean, go to my cousin's and his friends would play. We'd all, you know, play, trade cards, etc. You kind of learn, similar to what you said, that there's, you know, you're not alone in having certain interests and things like that. And these are people I talk to this day. I mean, we play other games mm-hmm. all the time. So... I got that from it. There are other games where some people, especially kind of in the journalism media currently, have given a negative aspect to it, but I never looked at it that way. And one of the things is the damsel in distress. Mm-hmm. And what I kind of pulled from that is that there are things worth fighting for. And it doesn't necessarily have to be to get, you know, get the girl as a prize at the end. It could just be for a close friend who... Mm-hmm. you know, means a lot to you. And there, it doesn't have to be a prize at the end of it so much as that's just what you do for each other. So, I mean, I kind of got that from it.
Cool. Dee, what about you?
It's hard to narrow it down because I've learned a lot mm-hmm. from a lot of different games. Like, I could say World of Warcraft. I learned a lot of stuff from WoW. Like, not just how MMOs work, but how to lead a team, how to be a part
yes.
of a team.
Yep.
Just, you know, stuff that translates into real life fairly well. I could say stuff about fighting games, how it taught me to be precise instead of, you know, just mm-hmm. you know, having epilepsy and flipping out. And,
which is what I do when I play fighting
yeah,
games.
Yeah, and how to strategize against, like, one solitary opponent. And stuff like that. But I'm going to probably surprise people and say the game I learned the most from is Final Fantasy VI.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah. That's the first game that I played, that I can remember playing, that had such an epic story, that had such
indeed
well-written characters and flaws with each character that drew me in. And my entire life, I wanted to be a writer. I wanted to be a novelist. I wanted to create these fantastic worlds and have them be celebrated like Lord of the Rings or Wheel of Time or, you know, one of those gigantic worlds. And I learned a lot about, like, story development. That game made me cry because I felt so emotionally connected to these characters. Mm-hmm. And just the plot twist. Oh, my God, World of Ruin. What? You know, just... And not only the story elements, but it taught me a lot about strategy, about how to build a party to counter specific things, or like with the last fight with Kefka, I guess spoilers, but it's been like 25 years.
Yeah.
you have to set up a team of 12 people to basically do like a four-phase boss fight.
Oh, wow.
And you have to set them up accordingly and be able to precast spells and all this other stuff. And there's a lot of strategy involved, especially for a JRPG. There's a lot of strategy involved in it.
Yeah.
And to this day, it's probably, if not the, but one of my favorite games of all time. It's one of those games that I will go back and play every single time I get a chance.
Oh,
I probably got 200 playthroughs through that game. I probably logged 10,000 hours into it.
Wow.
Just
damn.
Just a ton. And I learned a lot of that. Now, I could also say, cop out, say, I learned a lot from Number Munchers because it taught me math.
Yes. I
really
almost
good
went
with
there.
My multiplication tables, but I'm not going to cop out like
typing?
That. Yeah.
I almost went there earlier because I was having a tough time kind of thinking through that. And then, kind of going back to something Killer said too, because I was looking at my notes while you guys were talking, and I realized I forgot something key from The Sims, and you guys kind of talked about it a little bit too, is that, you know, sometimes, you know, you go through these different strategies, and, you know, there's different ways that you try doing different things, and, you know, think outside the box a little bit, and you know, you come up with these different ways of approaching different problems, and, you know, kind of trying to make things work, you know, set things that you do to kind of force an outcome. And one of the neat things about The Sims is that as you go through the different iterations of it, it's like there are definitely strategies that come out as you go through the game. Like, for example, Bio was kind of harassing me the other day when I was building the House of RivalCast. He's like, why are you building?
People will take that seriously.
Why are you harassing Baroness? Oh,
yeah, exactly.
to give some context, so in earlier versions of The Sims, basically, like, what I like to do is I was always more the type of, I like to build the house and then, you know, give personalities to the characters and then just kind of let them do their own thing and just sit back and watch what they do. So a very, you know, create them, give them certain traits, certain, you know, things that they love, things that they hate, you know, certain flaws, and then just put them together and see what happens. And, you know, just try to not manipulate them as much as I possibly can. And what I learned in the earlier iterations of the games is, like, you can give them free will, to so to speak, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to, you know, do what they should do. Like, if they're hungry, they'll probably just stand in the living room and bitch about being hungry rather than going, you know, three steps over to the kitchen and microwaving themselves something.
Wow, that describes so many people.
I know, right? See? Reacts to real life. So, in the earlier versions, you know, and you can kind of see this as it goes along too, is I learned that if you have multiple people in the same place, like if one person was using something and another person needed to use it, they would, you know, again, just stand there and complain that the other person wasn't getting out of the way rather than just going to a different one. So I would do ridiculous things. Like, I would have their main living area be, like, you know, pretty and okay, this is where I want to play. But then I would give them, like, I call them utility rooms, where, okay, if there's a bathroom and there's, like, six people in the house, there's going to be a bathroom with six toilets in there, so that people are just gonna go and do their thing.
We were
and,
talking about
yes.
that.
Well, you were I don't think we were talking so much as you were, like, appalled that I would build something.
Vampy and I were talking about that yesterday because she's making a version as well, and I was just like, yeah, just don't do the aircraft toilet thing.
Well, okay, so
have them in a neat little row.
So there's two things out of this. Okay, first of all, in Sims 4, which is the most current iteration, so I hadn't done a lot of live play yet. I was building the house based on the strategies from the earlier iterations, and so therefore I'm building this bathroom with, like, multiple toilets and a bathtub and everything, because again, the Sims in the older ones didn't care. They would just walk into bathrooms when people were using it, and they would just ignore each other and, you know, do their thing, right? Well, in Sims 4, that's not going to happen, because what we ended up happening was one person was in the bathroom with the six toilets.
Yes.
Another person walked in and immediately flipped out, just like they would in real life, actually. So this kind of ties into what my main point. Sometimes, even though you know what strategies you think are going to work, and you have an idea of how things should play out, when you actually let the live play go and you sit back and watch what happens, sometimes you end up with things that happen that are completely different from the way that you expected them to go. And sometimes, you know, you can do things to tweak that to make the experience a little more palatable in the future. And sometimes you just have to kind of play by the seat of your pants and see what works and what doesn't.
Sometimes life gives you a map editor that you weren't anticipating.
Exactly. Exactly. And yeah. I mean, and again, going back to Monday's gameplay, you know, you knew eventually that, you know, with eight people in the house, that certain things would just,
it's,
you know,
get real.
Something was going to glitch or something was going to go funky. And, you know, of course it does. So you're anticipating that. But yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And with hilarious results. I mean, let's just be honest. That was a really fun time. I didn't expect to be streaming for 4 hours of Sims, but... Anyway.
It's amazing how fast that stuff gets away from you.
I know.
When you're really enjoying a game, and like when you're just playing it offline or by yourself, whatever, you don't really notice it as much. But when you're playing it in front of people and you have a little countdown timer or a timer on OBS saying how long you've been streaming, you're like, oh my God, I've been doing this for 16 hours. And what?
Nuts. Just nuts. Boy.
So, yeah. So, I mean, that's, you know, you can't anticipate, really. I mean, you can anticipate, but sometimes things just, you do everything the way that you think you're supposed to, and then they just turn out wrong anyway, and you just gotta roll with it. So, awesome. So, great responses to that question. I was really looking forward to that one, because, I mean, it's not an easy question, and
yeah.
I don't think we really think so much about, you know, what we're learning while we're gaming, and you know, maybe we should, just because you do really get a lot out of it that people don't really talk about as much.
Well, and if it also depends like what your life is like when you're doing the game,
right? Mm-hmm.
Like mm-hmm. I grew up as an only child, so video games were big escape for me. Yeah, and I imagine mm-hmm. for you too.
Yeah,
like when you're playing a game and get really invested with it, if you don't have anybody else around, you start to feel like some of the characters in a well-written game mm-hmm. are your actual friends, and you start having...
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You start having feels when something happens to them, or when they do something awesome, or something like that.
Yeah, like, I grew up in an apartment, basically, where there were kids, but they all, like, this townhouse was typically where people moved, and we didn't move for a while. So I'd make friends for, like, a couple of months, and then they'd move on to something else. So I started to get kind of, cynical is not the right word for that age, but kind of, where it was just like, oh, you're just number so-and-so who's going to just vanish in a while.
Yeah. I explain so much about your bio.
It really does.
And I grew up like in a horribly, horribly poor family. It was just me and my mom.
Yeah.
And we were like at the bottom rungs of poverty, like going days without food and like having lights shut off and water shut off and getting evicted from apartments constantly. And it was horrible. But the one thing I had was my NES and later my Super Nintendo, which I saved up my
pet crap,
which I saved up my paper route money and bought, and I played it on a black and white TV.
Oh man.
And I those
memories, dude.
I grew up and I had an emotional attachment to these plastic items, basically. And I remember in fifth grade, our house burned down, our apartment caught fire, and we lost everything. And I wasn't distraught about anything except for my NES.
Yeah.
I was so upset that I lost that. My grandparents actually went and bought me another one, and it was like one of the happiest days ever. But, I mean, when you grow up by yourself, and I had a lot of friends, and I've had lifelong friends, and I call them my brothers and sisters now because they've been there since infancy, basically. Mm-hmm. But even when you have close friends like that, when they don't live with you, there's still a lot of time when you're by yourself.
Yeah.
And so having a method to cope with that, like video games, gives you a deeper understanding and a deeper appreciation of stuff like that.
Definitely. All right.
Those feels, man.
Yeah.
those feels. And that's, if it were the first time I'd heard that story, I would think otherwise. And that type of story, at least. I hear that from so many people. Like, if you go to Boogie2988's YouTube channel, he had, like, a lot of things in common with what you said, D. And it's just, like, growing up in that, and you had this place to go that told you, like, you know, yeah, the world's crappy, but you can make it better because
exactly.
of what you did.
I remember watching Boogie did a Draw My Life, And yeah, I watched that and I was like, oh my God, I know exactly what that's like. I mean, aside from the abusive stuff, but
right.
I know exactly what growing up like that is like. And it's not an ideal way to grow up, but it does make you appreciate things more.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and it's one of those things, you know, because you can shape that, it kind of helps you pull yourself out of that set, you know, where things just aren't the way they should be. It's like, you know, you can make a difference. And then, you know, in a lot of these, like Final Fantasy VI, as an example, you make that party, you meet these people along the way. And then you know, it's like, hey, we have this thing to do. Let's do it. We're the only people who can pull this off.
Exactly. Like against all odds kind of thing. And it makes you feel like you're a part of a group. When even you're controlling the group, you're not a character in the game. But you feel connected. You feel like, you know, you're going through the same trials and tribulations that they are. And it brings you closer.
Yeah. I mean, I can't tell you how many people have, I mean, sure, it's nostalgia a bit, but I mean, I know plenty of people who talk about games they played as a kid, and, you know, and pretty much everyone in the group's just like, yep, I was there. I played that.
Mm-hmm. I just introduced my youngest boy to Mega Man X.
Oh, nice.
Because we bought it on the Nintendo eShop on the Wii U. And he loves it. But, like, the stuff I think is really easy, he has a hard time with just because of the generation gap, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, just dash jumping is something that he has a hard time grasping. And I just do it like it's nothing.
Yeah.
But he's starting to appreciate some of the older games I loved when I was a kid. It's really cool to have that kind of connection with you know, your offspring. It's pretty neat.
Well, and you had that moment during your stream with your youngest when he was playing Sonic Generations, and I forgot, it was one of the maps where you had to do a lot of jumps onto rails and slide.
Oh yeah.
And he was just really, he was struggling with it. And it was that moment, I mean, where you're just like, you're off to the side doing something else, and he was having trouble, and you're just like, hey man, you can't give up. You can't give up. You just got to keep doing it. You'll figure it out. And sure enough, like a couple more tries and he nailed it. It's just like, I mean, that kind of thing that you can have with family, especially, you know, younger generation that looks up to you. That's just, you can't replace that.
There's definitely a lot of proud papa moments I have
nice
with my kids. Like my son, my oldest boy, he's really into FPSs, and he practices a lot with them. A couple years ago, they had like a Call of Duty tournament. I think it was Modern Warfare 3. It was four-player teams, and they had it in like this old theater and like on a projection TV. It was really cool. And he actually entered with some of his friends, and they got like sixth place out of 14.
Nice.
And I was just sitting there watching him, and I was like, oh man, I'm so proud of you. It was really awesome just to see your kids be able to do that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm just...
Yeah, I know. I know my dad's kind of had... He actually told me a couple years ago, and I don't remember any of this, apparently. Like, I vaguely started to remember it as he told me about it, but he was telling me... Like, I was playing, like, Zork and stuff when I was probably, I guess, around 4, something like that. It was just, you know, north, south, east, west, pick this up kind of thing. And I probably wasn't playing all that well. But it was like, you know, he worked in computer sales back before you had to go to college to do, like, engineering and stuff. So he was kind of a computer engineer / salesman. So he sold solutions to companies. And so sometimes we would have the stuff at home, so I'd get to play on these like old PCs. And he told me that while I was playing this, it was on a system where it was practically just half built. Like the monitor had a wooden case, and the wooden case was missing on this one, so it was just the tube like leaned up on a claw. And he had to like tell me repeatedly, do not touch that thing. It will kill you. Oh, so yeah, there's like little bio, like trying to, you know, play stuff like that, play Commander Keen and you know, some of the old shareware stuff. Yeah. So, I mean, I have fond memories from that. And I mean, he didn't like gaming like like you do with your son, D. It was just kind of funny. He brought it up, like, yeah, you know, I brought you a couple of games, and you sit there and play them a lot. And I barely remember these, but yeah, it was kind of funny when you look back on that stuff.
Go ahead, Baroness.
I was just gonna say I shared the pictures with Bio and Killer a while back of my early gaming with dad, where and I actually have like very vague memories of this, but just being very small, and you know, when before my brother was born, and when we were still living in the trailer, and basically he always played video games. As we got older, like my brother and sister loved playing them too. I wasn't as into them as they were, but you know, I always played around on his PC and you know did things like that, and then we'd blow stuff up in the backyard, and so those are my memories with my dad. And then you know he would they'd play Super NES together and you know different things like that. But there are actually pictures of when I was just a few months old, sitting in my father's lap with the joystick controller for the Atari, and he said that I used to just, you know, he'd put like Space Invaders or something on there, and I would just sit there and just like move the little stick back and forth, and I was just so happy about it until the little things would start beeping, and then I'd get like angry and throw the controller. So
I did that with my kids too. Like my oldest son, his very first toy was a Nintendo controller that I cut the cord off of.
That's nice. Awesome.
And he used to sit in my lap, and I'd be playing PlayStation 2, like Tekken or something. And he would just sit in my lap with that controller just like he was playing. And it was pretty cool. But I remember like when I was little, my mom, who isn't a big gamer, she dabbles. But anytime I would be interested in something, she would always take the time just to sit and either watch or play with me. Or like her big games, like she really loved Mappy, and she loved like Centipede, mm-hmm. and she got really into more recently she got really into Puzzle Quest and was playing that a lot. But I remember I was probably 13 or something. We had just got Super Street Fighter 2 on Super Nintendo. And so I invited all my friends over and we had this big tournament. My mom actually joined in the tournament with us.
Oh, wow. Nice. That's cool.
She got second place. With Chun-Li. All she did was lightning kicks all day.
Wow.
It was a good time. And my mom still talks about that all the time. Like, yeah, I beat you once in Street Fighter. I'm not going to tell her I let her win. But, but I mean, she not so much about like winning, but just the fact that she was hanging out with probably a dozen preteen boys, hanging out and just having a good time with us. It's even if you don't have kids or whatever, yeah. Something I've learned as a parent is whatever your kids are interested in, at least feign interest in it, mm-hmm. because then you really develop a bond,
right,
with your kids. And it's something that I didn't know my mom was doing, but she was doing the exact same thing when I was a kid.
And just it's one of those
using
things,
game as that medium.
It's one of those things too, where it's like if you see your parent as the one who's always kind of shooting down your interests, like it. I mean, does that not just kind of make you shut down a bit?
Yes,
it does.
You don't want to show them your interests anymore because you're just like they're gonna think it's dumb.
My oldest daughter is actually going through that right now with her mom. Because she's like really into all this emo stuff right now. And it's not like goth emo from when we were younger, but it's this new age emo. Like she likes a lot of punk metal music. Okay. And anytime you get her a gift for like Christmas or her birthday, you ask her what she wants. I want gift cards to Hot Topic, which, whatever. And her mom hates it. Absolutely hates it. But anytime she comes over here, we listen to her favorite band. She's into like Black Veil Brides and Pierce the Veil and all these like new age punk kind of bands. But on top of that, I've also got her listening to like old school Green Day,
right,
and Rancid and like Nirvana and the grunge scene. And she's really getting into that too.
That's just really well.
It just like we'll drive around and just like blare the stereo in the car and sing along to all the songs. And she loves it. Absolutely.
And guess
loves
what?
It.
You're probably the parent that she's going to go to when she has tough stuff going on.
Oh, you know? She already has. I'm not going to give you that because it's really personal. But
no,
like,
no, but she'll, no, call, no. Be, I
she'll
tell.
Call me. She'll call me and be like, Dad, I'm having this whatever issue. And I'm like, okay, well, we'll sit down. We'll talk about it. And it's really cool to have that kind of connection.
Totally.
But on the flip side, it makes it harder to actually be the harsh parent when you have to. Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Because you're like, I love you so much. I don't want to break your heart. We have all this great time together, but clean your damn room.
Yeah, but at the same time, yeah. I mean, you've got that relationship built where when you say something like that, it's going to have a little bit more impact because she knows
exactly.
You're serious.
I'm a big believer to give kids freedom, to let them express themselves and let them develop their own interests. And
sure.
Because it's one of the luxuries I had when I was a kid because my mom was working all the time. So I was alone quite a bit. So I got to explore all these interests I had and I got to, you know, devote time uninterrupted. And when my mom would see me devoting time to writing or games or whatever, she would always support me. She never once told me I couldn't do it. No matter how crazy my idea was like, Mom, I want to do the regional Street Fighter tournament in Chicago. She'd be like, okay, well, let's figure out how to get there. Which she did.
That's awesome.
It was awesome. I think that while you still need to be like a stern parent, you need to be a supportive parent because that's going to flourish the kids as they get older. And then they'll learn to be like independent and not reliant on like other people for the most monotonous things.
Yeah,
like
or approval. Just demanding.
Exactly.
Only doing things if it's approved.
Exactly.
Yeah. And that stuff like, I mean, comes to music and things like that. It could be a phase. It could be just what, you know, she's into at this time. Like you said, just let her work out her stuff, and if she needs help, she knows who to go to.
Yeah, like whenever I'm dealing with my teenage kids, I always try to think back to what I was like when I was their age, because they're 14.
Yeah.
They're 14. I remember what I was like when I was 14.
And dude, their stuff is worse. They've got the internet. We didn't have that.
Internet at 14. Yeah, I mean.
Well, I think I was 14 when we got the internet for the first time at our house. And we couldn't use it. I mean, our situation was stupid because it we got it because at that point we were in homeschool, and well, at least two of us were. My sister might have gone. No, she didn't go back yet. But regardless, like we had a computer that was supposed to be, you know, for learning stuff. And my mom, you know, we didn't have a lot of money either. I mean, it was,
sure.
You know, my mom was married at that point, but to somebody who she really shouldn't have been married to. And so she was working all the time. She was working, you know, a couple of jobs at one point. She made the effort to make sure that we had, you know, what we needed to have. You know, and it didn't always work out, but, you know, she tried her best. So we did have the internet. We just, you know, and we had a computer to learn stuff on. It's just we weren't allowed to use it most of the time. So
I think we had like teletype at that point. No, like there was this wire and I didn't know what it did, but there was a machine that would tap out, so I'm pretty sure, because my dad worked at the Associated Press for a while when I was
that makes sense.
Before I was born. Yeah,
that makes
so
sense.
He had like machines and stuff working on.
I think the first time I actually used the internet, I was a freshman in high school.
Really?
And that was like news groups and email. And that was basically it. So I would check
board services. BBS. Mm-hmm.
I checked one bulletin board and that was the Wheel of Time bulletin board. That's all I ever checked.
Wow.
Not only are you a nerd, you're a super nerd.
I'm a super nerd.
This message.
Yeah. I'm like nerd prime.
That's why we keep you around, D. That's why we keep
you have the
around.
Matrix of leadership in your chest? How do you do that?
Yeah, try to open it. Go ahead.
All right, guys. It's actually 20 after 10 at this point. So one of the things I love about like when we really get into conversation is time really does fly. And I know we try to keep this at around an hour, but I just love the fact that we are all nerds and we can just have these great conversations about really ridiculous questions, but I think a lot comes out of it. But To keep things flowing, we do have one more question that I wanted to make sure we got a chance to get to. And this is actually one of my favorite ones.
Of course it would be.
Well, it's entertaining. So here's the scenario. So for our off topic for tonight, finally sick of the ridiculous prattle about how horrible gamers are, RCM is abandoning ship. Hax has figured out how to actually engineer a magic notebook, and Baroness wrote us a portal to get to whatever game universe we want to go to.
Oh, so snap.
The question for you guys is, which game world do you vote for and why?
Oh my god.
I know, it's a hard one, right? But it's entertaining.
I got my answer.
This Killer, you wanna start us off then?
I will go first. I first got introduced, it's not a video game, it's actually a RPG pen and paper game.
Okay.
Okay. Still counts.
It still counts, I know. I was like, I made sure the questions, like, made sure it wasn't video, because, like, yes, I could use this one. Because it literally took me, like,
you know, I write these ambiguously for a reason, so yeah, you go with this.
I got introduced to this game about 2 years ago. If I had my choice, I would want to go into the universe of Shadowrun.
Ooh, okay. Yeah, that would be cyberpunk.
Yes.
I can see that.
Yeah, cyberpunk with fantasy.
I like it.
Yes, science fiction with all the magic you could ever want.
I like it. I like it a lot. All right, Dee, do you have a...
Are you still thinking? Idea. I'm still thinking.
You're still thinking? Okay. we'll come back to you. It's okay. For me, when I was thinking of this question, I was trying to think of, like, all the different games that I watch you guys play and that I've had interaction with myself. And so my first thought, you know, obviously was going to go to Skyrim, just because if you're going to live in a gaming universe, I mean, you can't get, I mean, and the reason for us leaving the current universe behind is because we're just sick of things. So obviously you're just going to want to kick back, chill. You want something that's going to be pretty, that you can just, you know, go off on a mountaintop by yourself and watch the dragons come by and, you know, mess with the Nords, you know, whatever. My first thought was picking Skyrim just because, you know, of just the beauty of the art in the game. But the more I was thinking about it, you know, that would be a great place to vacation for me in video game land. But one of the first video games that I actually played, and I'm not a big console person, so most of the games that I have interacted with have been PC. I play better with them and just enjoy them more. The very first one that I ever got was sent to me... Christmas of 1997 by my godfather, who had a propensity when I was growing up to send quote-unquote family gifts to the house, which were, you know, meant for all of us in a way, but really it was kind of centered towards one person. So I still have, if he ever listens to these podcasts, I still have all of the National Geographic books that you ever sent over, so thank you for that. But the game that he sent was a Lego game. It was the first Lego video game that they ever made, called Lego Island. And it was just, you know, a silly little game where, you know, you could dabble around, you know, just run around the island building things. And they had some quests, too, if you wanted to play quest mode, where basically a Brickster broke out of jail and he's trying to destroy all of the little Lego buildings on Lego Island and get to the brick of power and, you know, wreak havoc. So you could play a quest mode where you're trying to, you know, recapture him and rebuild all the stuff that he blows up, and, you know, it's just a fun game. And what I like about it is that, you know, you could go in and just create. You know, if you didn't like the way that something was, you know, you could go in and just, you know, a few mouse clicks and just change it to whatever you wanted it to be. So I would go there just because of the way that you can manipulate things to make your world how you want it to be.
Okay. Yeah.
That makes sense.
I like that.
Actually, I'm going to pop that in the chat because it's... I saved the link because I actually had to pull up the Wikipedia thing because I couldn't remember one of the characters' names. I mean, the writing was entertaining too because when you have characters with names like Pepperoni, I appreciate things like that.
Wow.
I do. That was the main character.
That cheese, yo. That cheese.
I know. And his backstory was pretty well done too, I thought. So, anyway.
Just because you brought up Skyrim, mm-hmm. I stumbled upon something on Reddit the other day. Somebody is making a mod called Beyond Skyrim.
Okay.
And the purpose of this mod is you can go anywhere in all of Tamriel.
Ooh. Damn.
So like Morrowind, Daggerfall, anywhere. Just expanding the entire universe. It looks super awesome. Oh my god.
Huh.
I'm so... I want it all over my face.
All over your face.
In and around my mouth.
All over.
Oh my.
It's everywhere.
It's in my hair.
Rub it all in my hair.
Yes. I love that movie.
Oh god, I love that movie so I had my kids watch it.
This is Wimblow. We trained him wrong as a joke.
Face the foot style, yes. How you like it? I am bleeding, making me the victor.
Oh, my.
I love that movie. Oh my, one of my favorite movies of all time. Kung Pao, Legend of the Fist. Go watch it. It's on Netflix.
And they never made the sequel.
I know.
All right. So is that your vote? Are you going to the...
Oh, no. No. I just wanted to bring that up because I thought it was awesome.
Are you still thinking?
No, I got it. Finished. I've got it.
Okay.
I got mine.
Okay. What is your vote for where we're going?
Okay. This is probably not going to come to a surprise as a surprise to anybody.
We're going to WoW, aren't we?
No.
No, I know where.
The world of Dragon Ball Z.
Yes! Yes!
So Bio's automatically changing his vote so that he can be Big Green.
Big Green.
Bio and I are going to play Dragon Ball Xenoverse when it releases, and he will be Big Green. And I will truly become the true guardian. Oh, it's going to be great.
Yeah.
No, but just if you look at it outside of like the Z fighters and, you know, the horrible enemies that come and try to destroy the planet all the time, you have, you know, a modern world where you have hover cars, capsules,
dinosaurs,
yes, giant freaking fish that you could feed your family for a year.
Exactly.
But on top of that, and the thing that one of the things that really gets me about the world is, say, for example, Bruce Wayne is walking down the aisle, down the alley with his parents, and they get horribly murdered.
Mm-hmm.
Well, instead of becoming Batman, he can just go find all 7 Dragon Balls and then wish them back to life.
Yep.
Death is not final in the Dragon Ball Z universe. Just look at Krillin.
God almighty.
Unless natural causes.
Exactly. But, I mean, on top of that, the entire theme about Dragon Ball is overcoming limits. And right. Just pushing yourself past boundaries to overcome certain objects. And in that world, it's more satisfying. And even if you're not a Saiyan or you're not a Namek, you know, look at Tien, look at Yamcha, look at Krillin. They're still, you know, super powerful characters.
Yeah, in comparison,
where you can freaking learn to fly.
Yamcha. I don't know who this Yamcha is, but he sounds disappointing. I'm sorry, I had to do it.
Had to do it.
Bravo. Yeah, by far and wide. And, you know, I would possibly be able to solve this recurring dream where I turn into a Super Saiyan and save the world. And I find out that I'm half Saiyan, and glorious things ensue.
Nice.
Nice.
Okay, so we've got Shadowrun. We've got Skyrim / Lego Island. We've got Dragon Ball Z. Bio, where are you voting for us to go?
Okay, so I want to say Dragon Ball Z, but for the sake of doing something different, because no, D totally sold me. I'm just saying.
I knew that was gonna happen as soon as he said that.
Yeah. I'm going there to present the world of One Piece, which is, you know, designed by a fan of Dragon Ball Z. So it's a world where, you know, laws are enforced by military strength, but if you're, you know, if you're strong enough, you can still do good and be a pirate, you know? It's a world where there's a lot of weird stuff. There are lots of legends of sea monsters and things like that. There's this place called the Grand Line where just everything is possible pretty much. I mean, it could be, you know, storming and then suddenly, you know, peaceful, and then it could be, I don't know, raining sheep, or I don't know, just all sorts of weird stuff. It's a place where you can make a band of friends and get a ship and just set sail on your own adventure. And the idea that one of the things that never really translates well when you're going from Japanese to English is the concept of nakama, which is a level of friendship that is like beyond camaraderie. It's just like, you mean the world to me, and you know, your problems are my problems. We're gonna fix this together. It's you know, a level that, you know, as American culture sometimes we have, but I think we don't have the same concept. We have something close. We typically call them, you know, brothers and sisters, even though there's not that biological link.
Mm-hmm. No, it's called a bromance. Get it right.
Yeah, there you go. That's true. That's a good point. So go for it.
Please tell me you've seen the Toriko One Piece Dragon Ball Z crossover.
I have, and it's incredible.
Oh my! Both of our universes can coexist, and yes, we can go to both of them at the same time.
And you know that for the creator of One Piece, that must have been the ultimate honor, because a lot of his art style was influenced by Toriyama.
Mm-hmm.
So to have his characters alongside Goku and the others,
wow,
that, I mean, that had to have been, that's his proudest geek moment right
probably
there.
Yeah, definitely.
I just have to say, I love how we're having this hypothetical conversation where, you know, Hax engineers a magic notebook, and you guys are already finding ways that, you know, you need to have a little bot to connect your two universes together.
Yeah. We need RCM bot, but,
exactly,
you know, for realms.
But it's a workable idea. I mean, let's just, you know, get to it. Chop, chop. While you guys
I'm just
were
saying gomu gomu no kamehameha.
Hell yeah.
while you guys were going through that, Hobbs, our wonderful little kitty cat, came running into the room meowing up a storm, and he wants to throw in his two cents. His vote for what universe we should go to is that Cat Goes Fishing video game that you showed.
I knew it.
Of course.
Where he gets all the fish.
He's all about that. He just wanted you to know that. Of course, Bio, I wouldn't stand too close to him in that universe because, as you know, he's trying to assassinate you.
That cat's out to get me. Not even met me before. So what's up with that?
You and Hax. I don't know what it is that you did to piss him off, but, you know, it's a cat. Who
I existed, apparently.
Yep. Yep, yep. Well, awesome. Well, we are at 10:32. Before we wrap up, any last thoughts from you guys?
Anything you want to plug, D?
Plug?
Yeah, well, you know, you're the guest.
Exactly.
Well, there's this thing called the WoW Podcaster Tournament of Epicness that's going on. The nominations are going.
Mm-hmm. They have Tuesday to get their final
nominations?
They have
until the end of the show on Tuesday to get nominations in, and then the tournament starts next week, or the week after, the week following. Mm-hmm. I keep thinking it's Sunday. And we're going to have a bracket, like fill out a bracket, win awesome, awesome prizes.
They are awesome.
Yeah,
we saw some of them before the show, and yeah.
Actually, the guy I have a friend who's a blacksmith, like a legit real life blacksmith, and he is making chainmail dice bags and chainmail keychains.
Oh man!
That he just posted the pictures of on Twitter, and they look super awesome. So those are going to be prizes for filling out brackets, and of course a bunch of WoW themed stuff.
I'm not gonna lie, because I'm here at RCM on staff. I mean, I'm not gonna go for a prize or whatever, you know, even if I happen to win one, I'll let somebody else get it, but I want to buy one of those dice bags from your friend, I think.
Norseworks.etsy.com. That's a store.
Oh, nice.
Mm-hmm. Plug.
Yeah.
Plug.
Good. A very, very good friend of mine. I actually met him in WoW, and he doesn't even play WoW anymore,
but
we're still friends.
Post it in the chat.
It's Norse Works, right?
Yes, N-O-R-S-E. And yeah, he does some really cool stuff. He actually does a lot of, I don't want to call it LARPing, but he does
like Ren Fairs and stuff?
Yeah, like Ren Fairs. He's awesome. He's got a full suit of plate mail. They do battles and...
yeah, this stuff's cool.
He's actually like in this community that he's a part of. He's actually like the king,
nice.
And he has a queen and like a council, and it's really cool. Just checking out some of the stuff on his Facebook page is awesome. But there's that, and then of course we have WoW Uncensored coming up Monday night, which nothing special. It's just the best damn show on the internet. So.
Exactly.
Hey, we were commenting before you came on. It's like D has a way when for WoW Uncensored, you Val and Bubba, have a way of getting people like me who don't. I mean, I only played WoW. I played in Wrath up to level 50 and was like, eh, this game isn't for me. I still tune into the show like every time it's on.
Oh, like half our listeners don't even play WoW.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
I just enjoy it. I like to hear you guys, because, I mean, a lot of stuff, especially when you're talking about guild stuff, that goes for any MMO, but it's hearing you guys kind of talk about it, and I don't know, it's just, I like it.
I just like the back and forth that you guys have, because, I mean, I'm at work when you guys are doing WoW Uncensored, but I still, like, pretty regularly will download the podcast afterwards so I can listen to it, you know, as I'm making my ridiculous commute across Cleveland. So I've never played WoW. I'm not really, you know, sure. They've tried to explain it to me a couple of times. It's just like, it's one of those things I think you have to kind of play in order to understand, but I love listening to the back and forth that you guys have. I mean, it's just, it's entertaining as hell. So
yeah. Yes.
So yes.
Well, it cannot be explained. You have to see it to believe it.
That's true.
You must breathe it. You must let it mold you.
So
you must get ganked in low-level zones by max-level characters and feel the rage.
Okay, so quick WoW story. I caused a panic on my server. I was on Alexstrasza.
Really?
Yeah. I went... So I was just trying to do map completion, okay? And I went into... I forgot which area. I think it was... the orc area. So I went towards their capital city, and they just started like pouring out, like the invasion's coming. And I knew it was like, I'm not putting myself in PvP mode. I'm not gonna fight these people. I'm just trying to get map completion. And it was just like, it's go time.
There's a lion scum at the gates. Charge.
Exactly. Yeah. It's just like, I'm just trying to get map completion, guys. Nothing to see here. Like I started charging into the city to try and get to that one waypoint so I could get their city. Of course, the guards come after me, and it did not work out.
Of course not.
But I tried several times. So, yeah. No, it's a good show, and I'm not saying it because I'm staff or whatever. I would listen to it anyway. Because, I mean, you three have a bond going kind of back to what I said about One Piece. Like, I think you guys have that Nakama going on. Because it's a well-known thing between, like, I've heard people just talking in general where they're just like, look... You do not try and get between D, Val, and Bubba. It's not going to happen. Just no.
People have tried. Break us up. Yeah,
it's just like Matt and Trey from South Park. They say the same thing about them. Like, yeah, if you tried to get them against each other or get in between them, nope, not going to happen. They're just going to ignore you.
Val and I have been compared to JD and Turk off Scrubs.
Nice.
Nice.
I still love the special thing that they did at the end of your Cannonball run.
Yeah, all those feels.
When Rex were competing and they had the giant heart of sandwiches.
Yeah, that I did not expect that at all. That was just I had tears. I had legit tears coming out because I didn't even know they were like watching or paying attention to it. I was just hanging out in our team speak.
Because they had popped in and then they went to another channel or something.
Yeah, and all of a sudden I see this thing, I'm like, what? Oh my god, you guys! It's basically
Good luck, buddy, go get him! It's dungeon!
I actually have that highlighted on my channel. If
I think I tweeted it when you
have it out.
It's just like, oh, those feels, man.
Yeah, it was definitely It was a lot of fun.
Awesome. Well, again, you guys can see WoW Uncensored Monday nights at 10 Eastern here on our RivalCast Media Twitch channel. As far as the rest of us, you can catch our articles and different projects that we're working on the main page at rivalcastmedia.com. That wraps up On Tap for tonight. Guys, again, thank you so much for being awesome and coming out and just having a conversation with us. As we wrap up tonight, just join us next week. We're going to have another great conversation, more staff guests in the hot seat, you know, just talking about different things that entertain us, and hopefully get some good word out of it. For those of you who want to participate in the conversation, again, we usually post up the questions on our Facebook feed, facebook.com/rivalcast, or our Twitter feed, at Rivalcast Media on the Twitter, just to post up the questions, you know, what are things that you guys are interested in talking about? And I'll leave that kind of sit there for next week. But again, be on the lookout throughout the week. We've got a lot of great material that gets posted up, a lot of great articles that are posted on the main page. And just tell us what you like and how you want us to grow, because, you know, that's what this show is all about, is growing our community and getting to know you guys better, too. So again, thanks for hanging out with us this week. We will see you next Friday at 9:30 right here on our Twitch channel. Have a good night, all.
Bye.
Night.
Later.